Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Less Heat, More Light, a guided tour of weather, climate, and climate change by John D. Aber. Narrated by David Stifel. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface. I have always been a climate geek. This may sound strange for a boy who grew up in a place some would say has no climate. As a child in Los Angeles, I was always wishing for more rain, more storms, more weather. The one time it did snow at our house, I was outside in a flash, making a snowball that was stored in the freezer until it evaporated, sublimation being the technical term. In an area averaging less than 14 inches, 35 centimeters of rain a year, and often receiving much less, I put a rain gauge in the backyard and kept wishing for something besides spiders to fall into it. Had there been a meteorological major in the college I attended, that would have been my choice, but liberal arts colleges aren't known for their applied fields of study. Still, as my career in environmental science has unfolded, climate and weather have always been a part of my research and teaching, and a never-ending source of fascination and intellectual challenge. Every semester, I have taught classes that included updates in how we measure, study, understand, and predict both weather, with a time frame of hours to days, and climate, years to centuries. In the 21st century, immersion in weather information has become commonplace. Is there any other topic in daily conversation for which we have instant access to such amazingly detailed images, driven by a process that ingests such huge amounts of data instantaneously? I suppose the stock markets also provide instant access to large amounts of timely information, but the weather community also makes predictions days into the future. With stocks, those predictions are left to the pundits. How this access to weather data has changed. As a 10-year-old with such a strong interest in weather, I received from my parents a subscription to the daily weather maps printed by the U.S. Weather Service. These arrived by mail 3 days after the fact. As a young professor at the University of Virginia, my department was privileged to have access to huge, high-resolution, hard-copy maps of current conditions from the Weather Service that were printed every few hours. When the Weather Service started broadcasting a live show with current information and maps, that was truly compelling and educational as well. It is hardly worth mentioning how primitive all of this seems now, compared with the instantaneous radar and visible images available in real time on every web-based device from governmental and commercial sources. Yes, we now have unprecedented access to timely information from all parts of the complex three-dimensional climate system and a thorough understanding of the basic physics that drive weather and climate. And yet our ability to predict weather more than a few days out runs into the wall called chaos, the mathematical variety. This is just one fascinating aspect of the weather story I explore in this book. But what about climate change? If we can't predict the weather in the near future, how can we possibly predict climate decades in advance? Although the proposition sounds logical, weather and climate, while obeying the same relatively simple physical laws, are constrained by different variables at different scales. An example of what is called systems analysis. The same system can be controlled and best predicted or explained by different factors at different time and space scales. Sounds illogical, but that is another part of the weather and climate story I find compelling and try to present. There is not a lot of new science here. In fact, one of the central themes of this book is that we have known most of the important facts about weather and climate for a long time. The analogy of a museum with thematic rooms comes to mind, and I propose to be your guide through four of these rooms, focused on historical context, the basics of weather and climate, how environmental research is carried out and applied, and how this all relates to our changing climate system. A guide can add value to the works on display by enriching the stories apparent in the works themselves. My role here is to dovetail different parts of the weather-climate story into a single coherent canvas. More specifically, I hope to convey three central ideas. The first is that the basic science behind both weather and climate is well known and has been for decades. Although there are remaining mysteries, especially around the role of clouds, the dynamic future of ice, and the impacts on climate oscillations such as El Niño, there is more than enough known to understand the basic patterns and processes and to predict where we are headed. We also understand how we can predict changes in climate over the coming decades, even though the accuracy of weather forecasts fades rapidly more than a week or two ahead. Beyond the cold, hard facts, I also try to communicate some of the fascination I feel watching weather and climate unfold, with some basic understanding of why and how we see what we see. The second central idea is that there is a pattern and structure to how we increase our understanding of the workings of the Earth as a single, integrated system through a unique field of research now called Earth System Science. The pattern is similar whether answering the big basic questions about the history and workings of our planet, or how those answers can be applied to environmental concerns. There really are few, if any, aha or epiphanic moments in science at this level. Major questions are resolved through a long period of give and take, measurement, and synthesis. We will discover just how long the timeline can be between crazy idea, initial dismissal, extended research by many, and final resolution. I pay some special attention to the role of computer models, as they have become integral to the understanding and presentation of science, and have been a focus of my own career in science from the very beginning. Finally, all of this background and context about weather and climate, as well as how science happens, are applied to the question of climate change. The point here is that we know enough to understand where we are headed and have known that for some time. My hope is that a guided tour of the science, as presented in this book, can help foster a public discussion of climate change based on a firmer understanding of the science and support a climate debate generating less heat and more light. A note on units. Most of the countries in the world, and all of the scientific organizations and publications, use metric or SI units to express weight, kilograms, distance, meters, temperature, degrees Celsius, and other variables. The United States is essentially alone in using imperial units, pounds, miles, degrees Fahrenheit, for both public and private communications. U.S. agencies like the Weather Service, NOAA, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, and NASA carry out their business in metric units, but often report publicly in imperial units. I use metric units throughout this book, but also give imperial units in a few places where the numbers will be more familiar to many listeners, or where graphics embedded in the text use that system. For temperature, F stands for degrees Fahrenheit, and C for degrees Celsius. Room 1. Weather and climate. Simple or complex? Chapter 1. Was Svante right? In what year did an early Nobel Prize-winning scientist make a first and surprisingly accurate calculation of how increasing carbon dioxide in the atmosphere would increase global temperatures? Who was that scientist? I have used these questions at the beginning of presentations in class or to general audiences as a way to break the ice and get the conversation started. The answers are almost always a surprise. The when is 1896, and the who is Svante Arrhenius. Arrhenius will be a touchstone throughout this book, as his story captures many of the themes I present. The first is that we know a lot about weather and climate, and have known much of it for a very long time. In a book written for general audiences in 1908, Arrhenius outlined a surprising number of the basic processes affecting carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and its impact on climate, including the role of burning fossil fuels. A second theme is the value of stepping outside traditional academic boundaries to address the big questions. Arrhenius's intellectual journey was a non-traditional one, even though he did win the biggest of all scientific prizes, the Nobel. The award was given for his work in physical chemistry. The interaction of carbon dioxide and climate was an intriguing sideline for him that occupied most of a year of grueling hand calculations. We will learn that many early climate calculators pursued this field as a sideline to their main careers. A third is the role of unstructured academic environments. That Arrhenius undertook his groundbreaking calculations on carbon dioxide and temperature at all can be credited in part to the innovative academic environment of the Stockholm Högskola, where he was offered his first academic position following years of traveling from lab to lab across Europe. A final theme is the importance of working with a stimulating set of colleagues from a wide range of backgrounds. When Arrhenius finally landed at the Högskola, he convened a rich assembly of inquisitive minds under the aegis of the Stockholm Physics Society. This group stimulated Arrhenius's attack on the question of carbon dioxide and climate, as well as groundbreaking work by others in meteorology, biogeochemistry, and global carbon cycling. Arrhenius's academic history, more than a century old, captures many characteristics of the modern study of climate change and its impacts. Much of the work is done in interdisciplinary labs and institutions that foster intense intellectual exchange and the constant give and take that makes the work of science both stimulating and enjoyable. Earth system science is one modern name given to the study of the Earth as an integrated system, and I feel it is not too far-fetched to call Arrhenius one of the founders of that field, in addition to his Nobel-winning work in physics and chemistry. So, more than a century later, Svante Arrhenius has inspired the creation of this book. In search of simpler ways to tell the climate change story, I read more deeply into the somewhat dismissive statements usually made about his early work on carbon dioxide and climate, and discovered a brilliant and wide-ranging intellect who was also dedicated to sharing his own very evident joy in the process and outcome of science with a broad audience. For all these reasons, Arrhenius is mentioned with some regularity throughout this book. Given that, I think that retelling his story here in a little more detail can serve as a valuable prelude to our guided tour of weather and climate. The only major biography of Arrhenius written in English is Elizabeth Crawford's Arrhenius, From Ionic Theory to the Greenhouse Effect. This brief summary of his life draws heavily on that source. Svante Arrhenius was born to a Swedish farming family in 1859. His father was not the first son in his generation, and so could not inherit the farm. As a result, the family moved to a small town near Uppsala, home to the oldest university in Sweden. One of Svante's uncles had earned a PhD at Uppsala, had established a successful career there, and is associated with the founding of its agricultural institute. Svante's uncle helped his father obtain the position of rent collector for the university, a position in which he also served for a local noble family. Svante's father was a conscientious manager who was able to leave his children a small capital bequest. Svante was tutored at home, attended local schools, and was admitted to the university at Uppsala in 1876. He was an above-average student with a facility with numbers and mathematics, always able to carry out very complicated calculations in his head. As an undergraduate, Arrhenius studied physics and chemistry, but the humanistic ideals that guided the undergraduate curriculum at Uppsala also required studies in Latin, history, geology, and botany. He completed his undergraduate work in only 4 semesters and began graduate studies at Uppsala, working with and between the programs in physics and chemistry. At this time, Uppsala and most European universities maintained a strict hierarchical structure where each discipline and department was managed by a single professor who exercised complete control over personnel, budget, and curriculum. Arrhenius's interest in both physics and chemistry displays creativity and a tendency to think across traditional disciplines that would mark his later successes, but was unlikely to be appreciated by the professors in each department. One said he had a brilliant mind, but thought him lazy and clumsy, concluding, "No doubt he has ability, if only he could show it." But revolution, at least of the academic sort, was brewing in Uppsala. Student unrest with the primitive laboratory conditions and the antiquated curriculum in the sciences led to calls for reform, to which entrenched professors offered stern resistance. Students looking for better opportunities, including Arrhenius, turned to the Institute of Physics at the Academy of Sciences in Stockholm for better facilities and a more open research environment. Another venue to be of special value to Arrhenius also emerged from this period of controversy and growth. In 1865, the Stockholm City Council set up a fund and a committee composed of 9 prominent citizens to establish an institution of higher education in the capital. As a result, the Stockholm University College, Högskola in Swedish, was chartered in 1877 and began operation in 1878 with a series of lectures on the natural sciences, open to general audiences. For quite some time, it was essentially a private, non-degree-granting institution, and was notable, among other things, for the appointment of Sofia Kovlevskaya in 1889 as chair in the mathematics department, making her only the 3rd female professor in Europe. It was also an open university, with unstructured curricula and an absence of exams and grades. Arrhenius spent a good deal of time in Stockholm from 1881 to 1883, while also pursuing a Ph.D. in chemistry through the University at Uppsala. His absence from Uppsala allowed him to focus on a research question that his primary professor in Uppsala had explicitly told him not to pursue. Arrhenius did not see chemistry and physics as distinct fields. The freer environment in Stockholm, at both the Högskola and the Academy of Sciences, allowed him to pursue the work that would eventually lead to the founding of the new combined field of physical chemistry and to the Nobel Prize. Arrhenius had hoped to earn his Ph.D. through the Högskola, feeling that the ability to grant such degrees would be approved in short order. That did not happen. The Stockholm Högskola, in its gradual transition into what is now Stockholm University, did not become a degree-granting institution until 1904, and not until 1960 did it achieve university status, becoming Sweden's 4th state university. Arrhenius produced an unusual thesis in 2 parts. The first part was a more traditional presentation of research findings on the conductivity of electrolytes in solutions. The second part was apparently something of a theoretical ramble, including 56 hypotheses or statements. This approach did not sit well with his official professors in Uppsala, and the outcome was not favorable. Rather than being awarded the highest degree possible for his work, he was given instead a fourth-class PhD, which effectively eliminated any chance of his continuing on at the next level in the academic hierarchy at Uppsala. Beyond that, his two major professors refused to recognize him during the very formalized process of celebrating each new PhD graduate, instead donning their coats and exiting the ceremony early and in haste. One colleague present at the disputation, or thesis defense, recorded these events decades later and said that Arrhenius's professors had decided to sacrifice him, as they considered theories and hypotheses worthless. The irony here is that the initial work that revolutionized both chemistry and physics by joining them in a new field of physical chemistry was criticized for venturing too far from the disciplinary norms of the day. His theory of the forces controlling the dissociation of electrolytes led to the Nobel Prize in 1903, and his derivation of the Arrhenius equation for the temperature dependence of chemical reactions remains a standard part of introductory chemistry classes. Both combine physical and chemical concepts. But in 1884, Svante Arrhenius was a young scientist at home in neither of the traditional disciplines of chemistry and physics, with a dismissively low grade on his thesis and no apparent future in his home country. He was described, though, as an energetic, affable, argumentative, confident young man. For Arrhenius, scientific argument was fun, and not necessarily cause for personal animosities. What I find so compelling about Arrhenius's story is that he was not cowed by his experience at Uppsala. Displaying an unusual level of confidence for one with no notable success in a traditional field, he presented his thesis and associated papers to well-known scientists across Europe. There he found appreciation and support, and the ability to share ideas with many colleagues across different fields of study and different institutions. He spent 6 years traveling among laboratories headed by leading scientists in Latvia, Germany, Austria, and Holland. It may also be both ironic and indicative that Arrhenius never did achieve the coveted status of professor at a major research university, through which he could have commanded both research and teaching agendas. In fact, at one point, he decided against accepting a second-tier professorship in chemistry in Germany, saying that he really considered himself a physicist, but also citing the superhuman diligence required of professors in that country. He questioned whether he could live up to the demands that would be put on him. But perhaps there was also a desire to avoid the highly structured and narrowly focused environment in which he would have had to work. Arrhenius's academic wandering finally ended when he secured a position not at Uppsala, but at the Stockholm Högskola in 1891. He was 32 years old and 7 years past his PhD. A private, non-degree-granting institution was not the natural home for a soon-to-be Nobel-winning scientist, but the freewheeling structure of this institution must have allowed and supported his wide-ranging intellect. It also provided him with his first actual laboratory for his own work. His first position at the Högskola was as a lecturer, primarily a teaching position, but his recognition outside Sweden led to a stream of aspiring students coming to Stockholm to work with him. He was eventually promoted to the position of professor of physics in the Högskola in 1895, over much opposition, but this was not the same as a position with that title at a major university like Uppsala. In 1896, he became rector of the Högskola, its most senior academic official, showing perhaps an interest in supporting and managing this unusual academic institution. In 1903, he was elected to the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences, again over strong opposition. But his tenure at the Högskola was also not a long one, by university standards of the time. In 1900, he became involved in the establishment of the Nobel Prizes, and was a member of judging committees for many years. He won the prize in chemistry in 1903, and in 1905 was appointed rector of the newly established Nobel Institute for Physical Research, located in Stockholm. There, he remained until his retirement in 1927. He apparently preferred this non-traditional academic home to the possibility of traditional professorships at Swedish universities. At one point, he described the Högskola as a place where there were people he could talk to. Perhaps traditional universities would have been too isolating and limiting. One of Arrhenius's first acts in his new academic home in the Högskola in 1891 was to establish the Stockholm Physics Society. This was a fluid organization structured around biweekly meetings of leading scientists across all major disciplines, as well as others in Stockholm society who would be interested in broad-ranging, freewheeling discussions of current and non-traditional scientific topics. This new organization was in part a reflection of its time and place in Swedish history, for the 1890s was a time of elevated national pride, of creative living, and an adventurous spirit. The Högskola can be seen as one expression of this free-thinking approach, but Swedish explorers were also engaged in several dangerous and novel incursions into the Arctic world, with ambitions of reaching the North Pole. It was a time of possibilities, of escape from limited ambitions and narrow thinking. Arrhenius was a man of his times in this regard. Even before receiving the Nobel Prize, he had left behind laboratory-based research in physical chemistry, perhaps because he felt the major questions had been answered and were no longer interesting or challenging. Rather than pursuing second-order questions or settling into a comfortable professorship and spending his later years resting on the laurels of his Nobel Prize, he remained incurably curious about science in the broadest sense, and recognized no boundaries among scientific topics. So the Stockholm Physics Society encouraged and supported conversations among people with wide-ranging areas of experience and expertise that would have been hard to convene within the tightly structured setting of a major university of that time. One all-inclusive topic Arrhenius pursued with his colleagues in the society was what he termed cosmic physics. Plowing through his language on this in different sources, I realized that he was basically describing what we now call Earth system science, treating the whole Earth as an interactive system, encompassing processes in chemistry, physics, biology, and more. It may not be too far-fetched to call him a founder of Earth system science, in the modern sense of a rigorous scientific field with hypotheses based on physical principles, as well as the founder of physical chemistry. But for Arrhenius, cosmic physics went well beyond the Earth and dealt with other planets, the Sun, the solar system, and just about everything else. As one definition of genius has it, he saw similarities where others would see differences. It is the intellectual hotbed of the Stockholm Physics Society that brings us to Arrhenius's work on carbon dioxide and climate. Imagine one of the biweekly meetings of the Society. Some in the room had been part of the expeditions to the Arctic. The affinity for stories about ice was a natural. The idea that ice ages had covered much of Europe, including Sweden, with glaciers more than a kilometer thick, had come to be generally accepted in scientific circles, but the causes of both the onset and the retreat of such massive amounts of ice were unknown. Curiosity about ice ages and concern for the possible return of the massive ice sheets lent some social incentive to answering the question, such that in 1894, a prize was offered through a scientific organization for the best scientific explanation. Also present at this imagined meeting might be the four scientists in addition to Arrhenius, who provided much of the intellectual vitality and broad perspective of the society. Otto Petterson was a chemist turned oceanographer with speculative interests in the interactions between the oceans and the atmosphere. Nils Ekholm was a meteorologist engaged in organizing Sweden's National Weather Service. Arvid Hegbom was a student of Arrhenius's who turned from chemistry to geology. He was really a geochemist before the term was coined, and an early expert on what we now call the global carbon cycle, including the factors controlling the concentrations of that element in the atmosphere. Wilhelm Bieknes was a young mathematical physicist who, during his time at the Högskola, established the physical basis of the role of pressure differences in the atmosphere in driving patterns of circulation and weather. It has been said that Bieknes's theories of atmospheric circulation, the foundation of modern meteorology, might not have been developed without the open yet rigorous environment of the Högskola and the Stockholm Physics Society. At our imagined meeting of the society, let's say that a presentation is made about ice ages, and discussion ensues about the physical processes underlying this major dynamic in the Earth system. Arrhenius, who is also aware of research carried out decades earlier on the heat-trapping property of carbon dioxide and its role in altering the temperature of the atmosphere, might speculate that changes in the concentration of this gas were responsible for ice ages. Hegbom could describe the long-term balance of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere due to geologic processes. Could these processes act swiftly enough to drive the ice ages? Petterson could discuss the role that oceans play as a sink for carbon dioxide, as the gas dissolves in seawater. Ekholm and Bieknes could add the perspective of meteorology. It would have been fascinating to be a fly on the wall for this kind of discussion, one that would have been very unlikely to have occurred within the hierarchical confines of a traditional university, and one perhaps unlikely ever to find a permanent home within that structure. The fact that cosmic physics as an intellectual enterprise disappeared in the early 1900s, having never found a home in a university department, emphasizes both the broadly interdisciplinary nature of the topic and the unique and valuable intellectual environment of the Stockholm Physics Society. It was his curiosity about ice ages, combined with the established knowledge about the heat-trapping properties of carbon dioxide and some preliminary data on the cycling of carbon, all topics for discussion in the society, that set Arrhenius on the arduous set of calculations that led to the derivation of what I will call the second Arrhenius equation. As early as 1894, in response to that competition to explain the occurrence of ice ages, he presented a paper describing the possible role of reductions in the carbon dioxide content of the atmosphere in triggering an ice age. The mid-1890s was a tumultuous time for Arrhenius. His short-lived marriage to a brilliant and independent-minded scientist, another reflection of Sweden in the 1890s, was dissolving. He was embroiled in a major controversy about his possible appointment as professor of physics at the Högskola, and many of his existing colleagues at other institutions were confused by the type of position he held, the institution in which he held it, and his jump from physical chemistry to something called cosmic physics. The Högskola itself was embroiled in controversy regarding its unstructured and free approach to education. Perhaps against this background, and with the stimulation provided by Arrhenius's Stockholm Physics Society colleagues, A deep dive into the topic of carbon dioxide and climate seemed appealing. Arrhenius cites the extraordinary interest in the topic expressed by his society colleagues as important to him in deciding to undertake the massive calculations relating carbon dioxide and climate. He was to spend a full year carrying out those calculations on what he called at the end a trifling matter. And yet, this trifling matter produced what could be termed one of the first global climate models. How did this model work? Central to Arrhenius's calculations was the established physics of the absorption of infrared, or heat radiation, by both water vapor and carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is now known to be the most important of human-derived greenhouse gases driving climate change. How long have we known of the ability of this gas to absorb infrared or heat radiation and to drive the greenhouse effect? This is another question I like to use in presentations and in class. The generally surprising answer is more than 160 years, or since John Tyndall first posited in 1861 that changes in the concentrations of water vapor and carbon dioxide in the atmosphere may have produced all the mutations of climate which the researches of geologists reveal. Arrhenius not only knew about the process of absorbing heat radiation, he also had data on the relationship between atmospheric concentration and the quantity of radiant energy absorbed. Essentially, how the strength of the greenhouse effect varied with the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. A characteristic of Arrhenius's work on this topic, which caused some undervaluation of the results by traditional colleagues, was that very little of what came to be important in his model was based on his own research. In this case, and throughout his research, he always gave full credit to the researchers who had developed the theories and equations that he used. In this sense, Arrhenius also foreshadowed the role that mathematical modelers currently play in synthesizing the current state of understanding and predicting both weather and climate. Although a first approximation of the effect of carbon dioxide on climate could be derived by calculating the direct effect of this gas, Arrhenius was aware, probably through conversations with the meteorologists in the society, that a warmer atmosphere could hold more water vapor, and conversely, a cooler atmosphere less water vapor. As Tyndall had known, water vapor is the most powerful of all greenhouse gases, so a more complete analysis of the impact of carbon dioxide must include changes in water vapor content as well. In either modeling or systems analysis, this is called a feedback, where one direct effect causes a second result that can either augment or reduce the impact of the initial effect. Arrhenius calculated the impact of decreased or increased carbon dioxide on water vapor content and the effect of that change in vapor on temperature, capturing this feedback. From a year of calculation, Arrhenius concluded that about a 40% decline in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere could have initiated an ice age. Our current understanding is that ice ages are initiated by subtle changes in the Earth's orbit and angle relative to the Sun, reinforced by induced feedbacks in the Earth system, including changes in carbon dioxide. But one of the strengths of the general result Arrhenius produced is that it can also be used to predict increases in temperature in response to increases in carbon dioxide. This is what has placed Arrhenius in the pantheon of founders of climate change research. I return to the details of Arrhenius's predictions and a simple equation summarizing his findings in Chapter 11, and then describe how well that equation performs using 21st data. For now, let's complete this profile of Arrhenius by featuring his dedication to presenting science to general audiences, and how he framed his carbon dioxide work in that setting. His masterwork summarizing cosmic physics for general audiences was a volume entitled, in English, Worlds in the Making, published in 1908. In this book, he treats topics as diverse as the origin and fate of the sun, the possible origin of life on Earth, and geological phenomena like earthquakes and volcanoes, all as part of a general view of the universe. It won't be surprising that many of his speculations were not supported by later research, but the section on the heat budget of the Earth, one that summarizes that year of intense thought and calculation, contains a surprising amount of knowledge we now accept as part of Earth system science. I was stunned the first time I encountered this list of statements. Remember that they were penned in 1908. The temperature of the Earth's surface is conditioned by the properties of the atmosphere. This statement is definitely true, and it was known before Arrhenius's time. Their theory has been styled the hothouse theory, because they thought the atmosphere acted after the manner of the glass panes of hothouses. This analogy is imperfect, as many have said, but the terminology, changed to greenhouse effect, persists. Any doubling of the percentage of carbon dioxide in the air would raise the temperature of the Earth's surface by 4 degrees. I test this prediction in Chapter 11 and compare it with recent rigorous assessments. It is not far off. The sea, by absorbing carbonic acid, another term for carbon dioxide, acts as a regulator of huge capacity, which takes up about 5/6 of the produced carbonic acid. The actual value is closer to 50%, but this is still an astonishingly early recognition of a major process in the Earth system and its influence on climate. The enormous combustion of coal by our industrial establishments suffices to increase the percentage of carbon dioxide in the air to a perceptible degree. Arrhenius did not foresee the tremendous increase in the combustion of fossil fuels in the coming years, and so predicted it would take centuries for this to have a major effect on climate. By the influence of the increasing percentage of carbonic acid in the atmosphere, we may hope to enjoy ages with more equable and better climates, especially as regards the colder regions of the Earth, ages when the Earth will bring forth much more abundant crops than at present for the benefit of rapidly propagating mankind. This passage reflects the concern over the relatively recently accepted occurrence of major ice ages and the potential for a new ice age to obliterate much of Europe. Arrhenius's writings and detailed calculations also included other aspects of the global climate system that have been verified by later research. These include greater warming at the poles, based on differences in nebulosity, humidity, clouds, angle of solar input, and the reflection of sunlight by snow and ice. Greater warming in the Arctic is one of the best documented effects of global climate change. Feedbacks with ice loss or gain, and decreased or increased reflection of sunlight. Increased carbon dioxide uptake by plants at higher concentrations of this gas. In addition to his prediction of a 4-degree increase in global temperature with a doubling of carbon dioxide, Arrhenius predicted an 8-degree increase with a quadrupling of carbon dioxide, and decreases of 4 degrees and 8 degrees for reductions of 50% and 75% in this greenhouse gas. When graphed, this gives a nonlinear relationship that has been summarized for application in an era of increasing carbon dioxide concentrations using this equation. Delta F equals alpha times the natural log of C divided by C0. I won't decipher this equation here or discuss the details of its origin, but in Chapter 11, I offer a surprising test of its accuracy. For now, I will refer to this as the second Arrhenius equation, so named to honor his year-long calculational marathon and first quantitative prediction of the effect of carbon dioxide on temperature, and in deference to the well-known first Arrhenius equation relating to the rate of chemical reactions. The Arrhenius story begins to tell us just how long the basics of the interactions of greenhouse gases and temperature have been known. His experience also demonstrates the value of the stimulation provided by a richly interdisciplinary and relatively unstructured academic and intellectual environment in catalyzing major leaps in our understanding of complex systems like the climate of the Earth. But can the explanation and prediction of future climates really be captured and conveyed in a relationship as simple as the second Arrhenius equation? What about the hugely complex computer models that generate the trends and maps usually presented as descriptors of our weather and climate future? Perhaps a medieval philosopher can help us dissect this apparent contradiction. Chapter 2. Occam's Razor and the Case for Simpler Explanations. What might a 13th to 14th century philosopher and theologian be able to offer to contemporary Earth system science and our discussion of climate change? Perhaps not a lot when it comes to predicting tomorrow's weather, but there may be some wisdom here in conveying the basics of the climate system to a broader audience. William of Ockham, 1287 to 1347, was an original.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.